Good afternoon, everyone. About 35 years ago, I first walked onto this little theater stage. And not much has changed. Even though J1 said at the start, he talked about how much things have changed, one thing that hasn't changed that much is the little theater. And another thing that's not changed that much is how much I love the subject I teach, biology. Let me tell you why. I love how a little molecule, a nanoparticle, can have such a huge effect. And I love how it's never just one molecule. And I love how there's always something new to learn. But let me start with a little story. When I was very small, my mom enrolled my brother and me in horse acrobatic lessons. Now you might be asking, what's horse acrobatics? I know I had never heard of horse acrobatics. Probably you've never heard of horse acrobatics, but this is what my mother had us doing. You see, my brother and I had just moved from very urban Tokyo, and we had come to a very rural part of West Germany. And suddenly we were surrounded by farms, fresh air, tractors, and every kid seemed to know how to ride horses. So we asked my mom, can we please take horse riding lessons? And so she enrolled us in horse acrobatics. And it's exactly as horrible as it sounds. There we were, the only Indian kids for miles, the only kids who had not grown up on horses, and we had to stand up on horses, jump from one horse to another, turn around on horses, and my favorite, this move. All the while being yelled at in German, Füße strecken, Füße strecken, which means stretch your feet, and all the while for those months I'm wondering why. Why does my mom want us to do this? And so one day, my mom's dropping us off, and she sees a kid doing that. And she goes, Amit, wouldn't you love to learn how to do that? And I go, Mom, that is what we're doing. Because you see, what had happened is my mom, speaking no German, had thought she was enrolling us in horseback riding, but ended up enrolling us in horseback acrobatics. And so we kept doing that for a few months, and then we moved to another activity, and I spent the next few months being thrown by big German kids from one end of the room to another, because my mom had still learned no German, and I'm pretty sure she enrolled us in the wrong age group. But anyway, you might be wondering, why am I telling you this story today? What's that got to do with why I love biology? And in fact, I had forgotten this story for a long time, until about 10 years back, when I started seeing these papers appearing about children growing up in rural Germany. You know those pastoral areas that Dr. Carpenter was talking about? In areas like that, children seem to have an interesting characteristic. While around the world, especially in the developed world, asthma and various allergy levels were rising, this wasn't seen in these rural communities. All over the world, in the developed world, sorry, we were seeing rises like this, where asthma and other allergies were rising 2 to 3-fold. And in the 1990s, when supposedly things had stabilized, the Robert Koch Foundation in Germany said the numbers only went up by 30%. Now, I could show you the slide for any sort of allergy, and I could show you the slide from any part of the developed world, it would look like that. And that rise is too rapid to be something genetic. It had to be something environmental. And so the question is, what exactly was it in the environment? And there were all sorts of great ideas. It could be pollution in the air, it could be diet, it could be cable TV, it could be microwaves, heck, it could be exposure to rock music or the Spice Girls. It could be any of those things we didn't know. And it was only when papers started coming out that talked about how children who grew up in agricultural communities showed a decreased chance of developing asthma. Now these children developed far less allergies that people thought, okay, maybe now we're on the right track. And this, and you may have heard of this, it's called the farm effect, the idea that children who grow up in agricultural areas, inhaling that kind of air, tend to develop fewer of these allergies. And it's just an offshoot of what people call the hygiene hypothesis, the idea that if you're exposed to some bacteria early on in life, that gives you a more balanced immune system later on and protects you from a number of these conditions. And doctors started saying, a little dirt cannot hurt. And it seemed to be about two things in the air that were really important. First, these, what are called endotoxins, a little bit of bacterial fragments in cow sheds and in other parts of the farm. And the second thing was drinking unpurified, in other words, unpasteurized milk. But for the longest time, this was just anecdotal. There was no real molecular evidence. And maybe it was just a cool theory. And so what I'd like to share with you today is some of the really interesting stuff that's come out just in the past year. So, in September, they published a paper showing that if you expose rats to those endotoxins I was talking about, the bacterial fragments in the air, something interesting happens. If you take mice and expose them to dust, they develop wheezing, asthmatic effects. That's what that mouse is showing over there. If you take the same kind of mice, but first show them these endotoxins, have them inhale those, then give them the same dust, now these mice are happy as can be. And what they published in September was there seems to be something in their lungs that can be isolated, a molecule called A20. That was interesting. But now comes the interesting part. When they took mice that hadn't inhaled those endotoxins, but put A20 in their lungs, and then had them breathe dust, they were happy. They didn't develop asthmatic conditions. But even more cool, when they took the mice that had been exposed to the endotoxins, but they now didn't allow them to produce A20, they blocked the A20, now put them in dust, these mice were very unhappy. So it seems that exposure to those endotoxins, those bacterial fragments, once again, results in the production of this molecule called A20 in our lungs, which results in some way protection from asthma. Now remember what I said I would love about biology. I said I love that small particles, literally small particles, that those nanomolecules can have such a huge effect. But I also said how it's never going to be just one thing. And the other thing I love about it, the fourth thing I love about biology, is that that argument is always going to move things forward. And so what's the other possibility? So it turns out we've also got this really huge community of friendly bacteria in our intestine, the microbiome. And they've shown that communities, rural communities, such as in India, in Germany, and even places as different as Burkina Faso, the rural communities have people who've got bacteria that are far more diverse, that the microbiome in the intestinal system is much more interesting. And that correlates with a drop in things such as asthma, allergies, and so on. Again, they knew this. But what was the cool thing that was published just last Thursday? Last Thursday, a paper came out showing this, that if you feed mice high fiber diets, they develop these rich, diverse bacterial, friendly bacterial communities in the intestine. And that's good for them. It protects them from things such as asthma. On the other hand, when you give them low fiber, high sugar, and what the researchers called a Western diet, when you give them that kind of diet, the mice don't develop those kinds of happy bacteria, or rather large, diverse community of bacteria. And so those mice are no longer protected from asthma, etc. But the cool thing for us, those of us who live in urban environments, is this. If those mice were then put on a high fiber diet, they regenerated a nice diverse microbiome. But here's the kicker. Last week what they published was this, that if pregnant mice are put on that low fiber diet, then the depletion of bacteria is no longer temporary and is no longer reversible. You see, when we pass through the birth canal, we're slathered in our mother's bacteria, and that's like a starter culture, if you will, for our own bacteria. But mice who have never seen that bacteria are never able to produce the friendly bacteria, and they're therefore not able to pass it on, and suddenly the depletions are passed on from generation to generation, and that 30% rise in asthma I showed you earlier suddenly starts making sense. And so it's just possible that those few years that my brother and I spent in rural West Germany did wonders for our immune system. But I think there's something else as well. I think those months falling off a horse into the mud, I think it helped me develop something else as well. Because in a wonderful book by Jessica Leahy called The Gift of Failure, she says that in this world today, where we're no longer afraid of a saber-toothed tiger or falling off a cliff, the greatest fear parents instill in their kids is now the fear of failure. And so when parents try to artificially engineer failure out of their children's lives, children, and this has been shown from data around the world, those children develop feelings of intense ineptitude, incompetence, they feel unworthy of trust, and they feel utterly unable to try new things. And they are unable to deal with the larger failures later on in life. And I think there's a real parallel here. Just like exposure to those few bacteria early in life can help provide a balanced immune system, it seems that exposure to a reasonable amount of failure early in life without any help can help children develop a balanced life later on. And so when you think about it, if you think about it just for a moment, when I was there falling off a horse, right, inhaling the bacteria, something interesting happened. Two interesting things happened, not just to the immune system, but also in terms of my character, hopefully. Because just like it would be impossible to create an atmosphere, an environment with no bacteria, it's equally impossible to create an environment in which there isn't some amount of failure for children. Now, of course, we could take this too far. And just like we wouldn't want an environment with no antibiotics, we wouldn't want a world with rampant infection, we obviously don't want a world in which children are so familiar with failure that they don't recognize success. I think the key here is balance. And I think, therefore, the greatest thing my mom ever did for my brother and me was that mistake she made enrolling us in horse acrobatics. Thank you very much.